great. It's so exciting to see so many people here. All of you, I'm sure, love the library as much as I do. So I wanted to welcome everyone here today. I was thinking this morning, 100 years ago, what was happening in the political situation 100 years ago? So I looked it up just because we're in the midst of this crazy time right now. And in 1916, on November 7th, Woodrow Wilson had just been elected to his second term. And it was during, you know, in Europe, World War II was being fought. And I thought, that's such a long time that this wonderful building has been here. So I thought I'd start with that. But I'm Satya Zoller. I'm vice chair of the Board of Trustees here at Tilton Library. And on behalf of the trustees, the library staff, and the Friends of Tilton, I'm so pleased to welcome you today to the rededication ceremony of Tilton Library. So the original dedication was held on November 14th, 1916, and like today's program, it featured a number of speakers and some songs. Tilton has always been a special focal point in the town of Deerfield, with its beautiful windows and the character of the building. Our library and volunteers are dedicated to offering programs, services, and technology resources to library patrons and to the entire community. We want to take this moment also to thank all of our patrons for your participation in the programming areas that connect the library with your daily lives. So you're going to hear later in the program more about our projected building expansion. And these expansion plans will allow the library to continue to meet the community's growing needs. As you can also see in your program, we have many special guests here today from whom you'll hear. But first, I wanted to introduce you to my favorite librarian, besides my mother, Sarah Woodbury. And Sarah's going to tell us about some of the people who've made Tilton Library what it is today. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for coming and helping us to celebrate our 100th anniversary of our beloved Tilton Library. My talk will be about 5 minutes long. If I feel like it, there'll be 2 commercial breaks. I'm going to be naming names, so if you hear your name, I want you to stand up and be recognized. And if you hear the name of someone, you know, give them a hand. So this is a serious occasion, to be sure, but it's also a party. So let's show Amherst we know how. Okay. Ellen S. Billings, the first librarian of Tilton, wrote, "A small library needs the help and cooperation of everyone to make it a success." Trustees, friends, and volunteers who served and continue to serve uncounted hours, never for any pay, nor for praise, but for the love of the library and for what it stands. Few people realize what they do and how many uncounted hours they give. So, current and former trustees, friends of the library, and volunteers, past and present, please stand and be recognized. Come on. Woo!
Thank you.
Ms. Billings began her tenure before this door opened to the public in 1916 and ended 36 years later in 1952. Right after the library opened, the U.S. entered World War I, and in 1918, a drop in the number of books and magazines circulated was attributed to conditions brought about by the war and the closing of the library because of the influenza. Those are her words. To serve newly arrived immigrants, Ms. Billings offered books in Polish, Lithuanian, and Italian. She also welcomed the bookmobile in 1940, held victory drives for books for soldiers during World War II, pleaded with parents not to allow their children to destroy library books, saw the exterior woodwork painted twice and the roof repaired once, and when she wasn't asking for more books, she wanted more shelves on which to place them. In 1939, library hours were Monday, Wednesday, and Saturday, get this, from 7 to 9 p.m. Tuesday and Thursday from 3 to 5, and during the school year, Tuesdays from 12 to 1. Despite what she saw as a problem posed by the increasing popularity of television and radio against the written word, a circulation count of over 13,734 books in her last year proved that people continued to turn to books to confirm or follow up new ideas and interests. The next year, assistant librarian Inez Smead took the helm. The new regional library in Greenfield began offering a film loan service, and Normandy 54683 became the library's first and current phone number. After the sudden death of Inez Smead in 1958, Louise White became librarian. The first mention of our good friend, Les Thomas, was made in that year's annual report when he initiated a library open house in honor of National Library Week. Les went on to become a library trustee for many years and has always has been a true and generous friend. We expected Les to be here today. I don't see him, but let's hear it for Les.
Yes.
In the next year, proceeds from a food sale paid for the Stephen Maniotti painting, which still hangs over the north fireplace. Two more open hours were added in 1961. Louise White resigned, and Rosalie Bechta, who's here with us today, became the new librarian. She's already standing. She's over there. Under her guidance, circulation increased, and 108 more residents signed up for library cards. In her last report to the town, Ms. Bechta noted that the lack of a children's room was forcefully brought to their attention. So now it's time for a commercial break. Did you know that the library is open now on Saturday afternoons? Okay. In 1966, Anne Rose became the fifth librarian. The library's 50th birthday was observed. RCA and Columbia Records donated 70 LPs for circulation. By 1970, four story hours were held for a total of 4 hours that year, compared to 50 now. The front steps were repaired and the exterior trim was painted again. In 1973, during the oil embargo against the United States, open hours were consolidated so that the building only needed to be heated for 3 days instead of five. Children got their own special area in 1976, and paperback, sewing pattern, and seed exchanges were begun. By 1980, there were 1,300 registered borrowers, and 21,960 items were borrowed. Ms. Rose noted in her report that year that circulation increases while funds remain stationary. By 1985, kids got their own librarian, the one and only Bette Schmidt.
Hi.
Come on. In an unusual arrangement with the school, Bette became the resident school librarian at Tilton 3 days a week, while Kathy Murphy Moss worked as the Tilton Children's Librarian. In 1986, after 22 years, Anne Rose retired, and Ruth Urell, who was remembered for knowing everyone's name and library card number, and who is with us today from her new position at the Board of Library Commissioners in Boston, became the library's sixth director. Ruth will be speaking later, so we can cheer her now.
Okay.
And then. During Ruth's time, books for teens, audiobooks, and videos were added to the collection. A copy machine, computers, modem, printer, and fax machine were installed. Construction on the small addition to the south of the building was begun, and the Joseph Savage Fund was established. Time for a commercial break. Did you know that potatoes from the fields of Deerfield come back to town as Utz potato chips?
I do.
Chris Pekarski filled in when Ruth left in 1996. Is Chris here today?
Yes.
Hi, Chris. Welcome back. The trustees asked the town for $36,000 for the wheelchair lift, and in April, the Friends of Tilton Library was formed. By 1998, free public internet access was offered. Ann Kurt came on staff, and... Thank you. Barbara Schumann was hired as director. Barbara. Nancy Maynard, then Nancy Gavrick, came on board, and the exterior trim was painted once again. Barbara retired at the beginning of 2006 after completing a long-range planning process, which resulted in a plan used as a model statewide. During this time, Wednesday morning hours were added, and Julie Cavaco, Debbie McQuillan, and Brenda Lynch came on staff. Thank you. I've been here for a happy decade and have seen the increase in the publication of digital books, audiobooks, movies, and magazines. We became full members of CWMRS in 2006 and saw the end of the regional library and bookmobile services in 2009. As far as I know, Alan Fowler was the first male employee to work the circulation desk beginning in 2008. In 2013, library trustee and friend Dave Lamb repaired and refinished the mothballed original circulation desk and returned it to Tilton in its original splendor. And you can see that later. The roof and furnace were replaced, the front steps repaired, and almost on schedule, the exterior trim was painted. As in the past, we still need and we read books and we still need more space. Looking ahead, next January, we will submit an application to the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners for a library construction grant for an addition to our lovely old building. If the project goes through, teens will finally have their own space. We will once again have a meeting room. And for at least the next 20 years, the lack of space will be a thing of the past. Tilton Library will change, and yet it will remain the same. Let's hear for the next 100 years.
Thank you, Sarah. My name is Judy Holmes. I am the co-chair of the planning and needs assessment committee for the new edition. And I am here to talk about the future. We sincerely hope that in the not too distant future, we will all be gathered in the same spot to dedicate a brand new edition on our beloved library, and a much needed edition. Our committee has been working for about 2.5 years. Before we sat down with any architects, we did a very thorough needs assessment process. We talked to as many people as we could to get as much feedback as possible about what town residents liked and didn't like about their library. We held community meetings, focus groups, library visioning exercise, and we distributed a survey at the November 2014 elections. Our committee also visited a dozen other libraries in Western Mass that have had additions built on so that we could see what a truly modern library was able to offer to its town residents. As we moved into the next phase with the architects, our needs assessment produced a voluminous document called the Building Program, which is available online if you'd like to see it, which details step by step, space by space, the kinds of things that we envision for a truly modernized library. When this library was built, the population of Deerfield was about 2,000 people, and the population of Deerfield now is about 5,500, I believe. So it was more than less than half the population of today when this original building was built, and it no longer serves the needs of our town. The committee had some very clear vision for the new addition to the library after talking and meeting with so many people in the community and finding out what they thought. And we established some overall goals for the addition. I think the first thing is that we want to make sure that the addition maintains and highlights one of the town's most historic buildings as a focal presence in the center of our town. We want to make sure that any addition is in the back of the building and doesn't in any way detract from the presence of the facade and the front steps and the entryway of this building as it's been for the last 100 years. We also want to preserve the essence and feel of the current library while modernizing and expanding it so that it meets the needs of our town residents. It would probably be cheaper to tear this building down and build a brand new library, but that's not what our committee wanted to do and would even consider doing. We also want to build an addition that is worthy of the original building and that will meet our needs for at least the next 20 years. And finally, we hope that this building will add to the community pride that we all have in our town here. So I invite you after we've done with the presentations out here, there's plans and drawings inside, and I'd be glad to walk you through what we hope to see in the near future. I also noticed as we start talking about this addition, for the first time the sun has come out since we've been here. I see that as a very good sign. So I will now turn this over to Jay. Mm-hmm.
Carolyn Ness.
Thank you.
I have the opportunity to read some citations from our Representative Jim McGovern and the Governor and Stan Rosenberg. But I just want to say what a wonderful opportunity it is to celebrate a central part of our community. The Tilton in my 36 years here has always been a central part for me. I love coming to the library with my children. We were obviously, I guess, one of the first kids that took advantage of the children's library and space, and now my grandchildren. We're here to celebrate the past, but also the future. I think in the modern era of social media, I think having a safe, central gathering spot in the community to reinforce our community values is even probably more important than in the past. So I'm hoping that the community will come out and support the addition, and we will all be here again having a big celebration soon. The first citation is to the Tilton Library on behalf of the citizens of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Governor Baker would like to extend warm greetings on this joyous occasion of the 100th anniversary on the 5th day of November 2016. And it's signed both by the governor and the lieutenant governor. Jim McGovern wrote, "With regret, I am unable to attend today's event due to scheduling issues, but I am pleased to have the opportunity to comment on this special occasion and celebration of 100 years of service by a truly outstanding community space, Deerfield's Tilton Library. It's great to know so many people care so deeply about this milestone, and I truly wish I was able to be in Western Massachusetts with you today. There are not many words to express enough appreciation and praise for the superb programs and services provided by the Tilton Library. Your efforts have benefited hundreds of children and families. As Nancy Maynard, Chair of the Library Board of Trustees, has expressed the importance of this communal space, I also believe that your dedicated teams of staff and volunteers have greatly enhanced the quality of life for countless people. Through your valuable service, all your help, the children, young adults, and families you serve build lives that can be proud of lives with productive intellectual practice, enthusiasm for innovative learning. As Congressman in the 2nd Congressional District of Massachusetts, I am in constant awe of your commitment and always proud to recognize, applaud, and thank you for these impressive years of excellence. By now, you have countless success stories of the Tilton Library, and I know you will add to this impressive tally in the years to come. Sincere congratulations on this wonderful occasion. Please be assured of my continued support in Congress of your great efforts in fostering a shared sense of community. Sincerely, James McGovern, your representative." And Stan Rosenberg sent something quite impressive. It's his citation. It's known that the Massachusetts Senate hereby extends congratulations to the Tilton Library in recognition of its 100th anniversary, and it be further known that the Massachusetts Senate extends its best wishes for continued success, that this citation be duly signed by the President of the Senate and attested to and a copy thereof transmitted by the Clerk of the Senate. And here are the official signatures from Stan Rosenberg. Thank you.
Thank you. Stephen Kulik, First Franklin District.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Good afternoon, everyone. It's really a pleasure for me to be with you today. I am a big fan of libraries, and I started in politics, if you call it politics, to be a library trustee, but in public service in my community, I was a library trustee about 40 years ago in Worthington, and one of the things we had to do as library trustees, we didn't have an official librarian, so we had to check the books out once a week. We each had 2 or 3 hours, and it was a terrific way to meet people in the community, and I have to say it was probably the start of my, you know, elected official position, in that I got to know a lot of folks, and there's nothing better. There's no better place in any community to get to know people and to understand what makes a community thrive and prosper than in the library. And, you know, you would think that in the day of very savvy technological advancements and people's reliance on the internet and all of the electronic information age that we're in, that libraries might be a dying breed. But it's just the opposite. People have been relying on libraries more and more in the last 20, 30 years. Circulation is up here. It's up at every library in the 19 towns in my district. It's up around the state. And we have really a challenge every year in providing state funding to supplement what you provide at the local level to support the technology investments, the library resource sharing, and other accounts that come through the state budget to this library and every library in the Commonwealth. They're vitally important, and your advocacy as patrons, as trustees, as supporters, as people who use the library is very important every year. Just last Friday, Sarah and I met along with some of her colleagues from the area to talk about how people can advocate for libraries more effectively every year in the state budget, which happens in the spring every year. And so I encourage you, as we get into the next state budget season, to talk with Sarah, find out how you can advocate, send me emails, send Stan emails, write us notes, give us a call. Let us know how important the Tilton Library is to you, and we'll do our best to make sure that we provide some state resources to support your efforts. And I'm so pleased to hear about your future plans. We've seen a number of neighboring communities build new libraries or add on to older libraries like you're planning to do here at Tilton to maintain the historical integrity of this wonderful building and yet equip it for the future needs of this community and the people who are going to utilize this library. And so I commend you for, Judy, what's a very thoughtful process you've gone through and very comprehensive plans. And when you submit that application to the Board of Library Commissioners, I look forward to working very hard to make sure that that grant is successful, that you'll be, I'll do what I can, absolutely, because I know how long you've been working at this. It's been a while, and I know there's been a lot of interest in meeting the future needs of this town for good library facilities. And it's so important to the youth in particular, but libraries serve people of all ages and of all needs, and the newly expanded and improved Tilton Library is gonna serve the generations of this community for many years to come. So I look forward to working with you on that. So let me provide a citation as well. I have to say, I think it's even more impressive than my friend Stan Rosenberg's. You know, we have a beautifully embossed white seal of the Commonwealth on it and a gold seal with a blue ribbon. And I'll read it for you. It says, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, House of Representatives, be it hereby known to all that the Massachusetts House of Representatives offers its sincerest congratulations to the Tilton Library in recognition of the joyous celebration of your rededication, for being an integral part of the Deerfield community, and for your 100th anniversary. It's given this fifth day of November 2016 at the State House, signed by the Speaker of the House, Robert DeLeo, and very proudly by me as your state representative. So congratulations and thank you to everyone. And so many people have stood up this morning or this afternoon who have been a part of the library over the years. So I know you've contributed a great deal. Thank you for your support, for your public service, for keeping the library a strong and vital part of this community. And I look forward to many great years for the Tilton Library ahead. And thanks for inviting me to be with you today.
Thank you. Thank you. Ruth, welcome home, back.
Thank you. So this is a great honor and a great pleasure. And Chris, hello. We worked together for years, and I see Ann Kurt, and was so thrilled to see Bette and Pam. And I just want to say that you can call him Les Thomas, but he was always Mr. Thomas to me, and I think remains so. So I was reminiscing a little bit, and we had our 75th anniversary while I was here. When I first came here, Ann Rose was the librarian, and we were putting little, Ann will remember, I think, Ann. We were putting little flags on the books that people wanted to borrow because we had no better way. We had these long lists. We had no better way of keeping track of who was asking for what. And we knew we needed to do something that was a little bit more, say, 20th century. So we figured out, and a bunch of us got together from the five frontier districts and pushed hard on old CW Mars to create a way for us to participate in actually online thinking. And it was a giant leap into the 20th century. And I want to mention about the addition also, because we're talking about those windows. One summer there were people outside scraping those window frames, and they were drenched with sweat. It took them about five times longer than they had expected when they put their bid in. And I felt so sorry for them. I'd be passing them water out the window. I mean, it was really very, very antique. But the inspiration, so passionate, one of my passions, still a librarian, is to create broader access. And I think when we talk about access in libraries, we really mean a deep philosophical and physical availability of the resources that people need at any point in their life. And this is a core value that we hold. And being here before that little addition, it was 13 hard steps up to get through, at the time, the double doors. And the irony was that when they had to replace the double doors, they had to replace them with an accessible entrance. Get that. So I said, well, what are we doing that for? We have 13 steps. So anyway, we put that little railing in because there was a gentleman who had a stroke, and he couldn't manage those two steps out there without something to pull himself up. And then it was a lift to get people in, because there really were so many people. We had a trustee who had a broken hip. And for 8 months, she couldn't get into the library. So, you know, just thinking about these things, I think the more we can do to make our public facilities open to all and available to all when they need them, and by all, I mean all the great unwashed, I'm all for it. So just on a more practical note, I just finished a building project in Reading, and it took years off me, but I know the process now and can help a little bit, I think, to recommend some libraries to see, and to how to get through that OPM and the PJ and the GC and all that stuff. So I'm happy to help. I'm sorry I'm taking some time, but I just want to mention on a personal note, this was 11 years for me, and it was the time when my children were being born and being raised. Bette had a baby shower for my second little guy, and their
fine, strong sons now, and it just was a wonderful time in life and a wonderful place to be, and warm and welcoming community. So thank you for those wonderful years, and thank you all. I have I just want to mention to our esteemed representative that I'm pretty sure this probably isn't 50 cents worth of material from the Board of Library Commissioners. We're always struggling for money. I work for the Board of Library Commissioners now as a development and advisory specialist, and the commissioners met on Thursday and send you their very most sincere congratulations and the proclamation that I will read. From the Commonwealth of Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners. Whereas the Tilton Library has promoted knowledge, literacy, and cultural enrichment through its services and collections for the benefit of the people of Deerfield and surrounding communities since 1916, and whereas the town of Deerfield has shown its commitment to strong library services by offering activities and learning opportunities that engage and enrich all ages, and whereas the trustees and staff of the Tilton Library have created a professional and welcoming environment for discovery, exploration, and growth, and whereas the Tilton Library has been cared for and supported to serve as the heart of the community for 100 years and will continue to meet the needs of future generations in Deerfield, and whereas the Tilton Library stands as proud and vital today as it was at its founding a century ago, thanks to its countless community supporters, therefore be it resolved that the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners recognizes the many achievements of this first 100 years of the Tilton Library, and be it further resolved that the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners enthusiastically congratulates the citizens of Deerfield and the trustees and staff of the Tilton Library as it journeys on into its next century of service. Thank you.
Who's up?
Well, it's so nice in this free country of ours that so many subversives can gather in the open. Now, it's actually worse than that. You are all here today because of Satan. 400 years ago, when they got off the Mayflower, they decided all children needed to learn to read. This was revolutionary. In the rest of the world, there were people interested in teaching boys to read. They weren't as interested in the girls, and I noticed that the girls take to reading better. Excuse my head count. But one of the first laws of education in Massachusetts was called the Old Satan Deluder Act. Lest the children be led astray by Satan, they had all needed to learn to read the Bible for themselves. Now that was a little door that opened up to many other things, because once you start to read, you start to think. Now that was actually an older idea. 500 years ago, Martin Luther discovered Gutenberg, and he discovered not just that the Bible could be printed in German and French and people could have it in their own language, he could make pamphlets, political pamphlets, to promote his view of Christianity. So he was planting seeds. But I think as New Englanders, we should take great pride in the role of literacy and libraries and the long history of, I would call them saints. Tomorrow's All Souls Day. There were many, many people around New England, people of means who left sums of money or invested money while they were still alive in promoting literacy. The history of libraries in Deerfield, though, started actually among a group of people called the River Gods. These were the rich families that owned the big plots of land up and down the river that made this such a desirable area. It's why we took it away from the Indians. In fact, they called it the Nile of New England because it floods and it keeps rich, so all that soil was available. But only the wealthy could have libraries. Books were so expensive, they had their own private libraries. Most of them were theological. But slowly things changed. We use the word revolution so casually. But after the revolutions, things changed. Suddenly people were interested who were not the wealthy. So in Deerfield, they were still people of means, had libraries that they gathered together by subscription, so you could buy into it. Other times they got together to buy a set of encyclopedias. Some of the leading citizens of Old Deerfield, including the physician, bought a encyclopedia to share. But as time went along, they became less and less interested in reading the Bible and reading other things. Right after the Revolution, there was a social library, and it only had about 800 books. But it had 101 of those were history, and 73 were theology and ethics. But something had crept in. 99 were novels. So in the early 19th century, even calling it the social library, it was a means of getting together with your neighbors and talking about ideas. And as time went on, by the 1840s, Deerfield had a juvenile library. Reverend Willard, who had come from Harvard, the first minister in Deerfield not to be from Yale. It was troubling. But he didn't like how the children were being treated, so he started a juvenile library out of his home and eventually became the church library. There was a military library in the 1840s, and also an agricultural one. Many of the one-room schoolhouses around Deerfield had at the back of the room bookshelves where the latest in the science of agriculture was available to the farmers. In fact, Professor Hitchcock, who was from Deerfield and went to Amherst College in the 1850s, he was sent to, of all places, France and Germany, to learn about agriculture, and he came back and started what became UMass as a school for farmers. And it wasn't that the farmers didn't know anything, it was this great value that was placed on knowledge, that our problems of feeding the world could be met through scientific agriculture. But in closing, I would say I greatly approve of your plan not to tear this building down. We share a birthday because part of Memorial Hall Museum, PVMA's library, PVMA's museum, was built this same year. Its first floor is now our music room, but the two floors above it were built as a library. That was mostly for research purposes. But if you go there today, there's a whole extra wing on the side beyond that, so we didn't have to tear down anything to add a modern library for researchers. So best of luck with that. I think the book is far from dead. And for one reason, I know that we pass them around from one library to the other when we have our book sales. So thank you so much for your donation last time. And congratulations on 100 years.
Thank you, Tim. Joyce Burrell. Thanks, Joyce.
Hi, I'm Joyce Burrell. I'm past president of the South Deerfield Women's Club and the current treasurer. I don't know if, excuse my voice, probably the cold weather. I don't know if any of you realize the long association the Women's Club has had with the library. By 1916, the Women's Club had many fundraisers and had raised over $900 toward the library. In today's dollars, that would be about $21,000. They used that money to furnish the what became the village room. This was originally called the assembly room in the basement. This was a 20 by 30 foot room with a seating capacity of 125 and had a stage that was 8 by 20 feet. Adjoining that room was a kitchenette, and the Women's Club furnished the assembly room with linoleum for the floor, chairs, furniture for the stage, china, silver, glass, and an electric plate for the kitchenette, and a piano. The club also paid for two handsome electric lamps outside the front entrance of the building, which I don't think are there anymore. But when I first joined the Women's Club, we were still meeting in the assembly room, which became the village room. And at that time, tea and coffee were served by members seated at opposite ends of a long table on the stage, from a silver tea service and a silver coffee service, on china cups and saucers with china plates for dessert. It was eventually, though reluctantly, voted to change to paper plates and cups because, while the kitchenette had running water, it didn't have hot running water. So to do cleanup, you had to heat the water on the electric plate, which took quite a long time and was not very convenient. One of our life members seems to remember that the Women's Many Women's Club's members help with some of the repainting, and I don't think it was the outside painting, so maybe it was indoors. Possibly the new children's room, I have no idea. So that was probably in the late 70s or 80s. The club continued to meet in the village room until 1982, when the space was converted into the children's room. Presently, the club continues to support the library each year with monetary donations, and we also usually have at least one program at our meeting with a local author. This year we have Kevin Kelly talking about his book, Both Sides of the Line. We look forward to the possibility, hopefully, of returning to meeting in the library in the very near future once the addition is built. So I thank you.
Thank you, Joyce. And now, Samantha Baker.
Hello, everyone. My name is Samantha Baker, and I'm a patron here at Tilton Library. I'm 11 years old, and I've been coming here for over 10 years. I enjoy using the computers and bringing my friends to the library. The first place my mom brought me when I was born was Tilton Library. I've gotten to know all the staff and wish Tilton Library a happy 100th anniversary. Thank you.
Oscar Potter.
Hi, everyone. I want to thank Sarah and Julie for asking me to speak, and I want to thank all of you for coming to the 100th anniversary of this amazing library. I obviously wasn't here when this library was made 100 years ago. And until recently, I didn't even know it was 100 years old. It doesn't look its age. I'm a pretty lucky kid. I love reading and always have. My parents read to me every night when I was littler, and now I read every night. I know for a fact that some kids' parents don't read to them as they get older, and it makes me really sad that those kids miss out and don't get to enjoy all the incredible stories that I've loved. The Tilton Library has nurtured my love of reading and more. When I think about the Tilton Library, I don't just think about it as a place to get books. I think about it as a place to get a snack, a place to hang out after school, a place to see a community concert. There always seems to be some kind of new thing to keep kids entertained, whether it's a game night, freeze pops, or prizes for reading over the summer. There's one person who stands out to me when I think about the Tilton Library. It's hard to overstate how much of a part of the library Julie is. She goes out of her way to welcome new kids and families and keep kids coming back time and time again. Martin Luther King said, "We are tied together in a single garment of destiny." The Tilton Library is our community's shared garment, and Julie is the zipper. I truly hope the Tilton Library lasts another 100 years so that I can keep bringing joy and good books to the people of South Deerfield. It's a historical landmark at this point. I know that I won't be here in another 100 years, but I hope that my grandkids will have the chance to see it and enjoy Percy Jackson, Harry Potter, Calvin and Hobbes, and all the other wonderful book characters that are yet to come. Thank you again for coming to this 100th birthday celebration of this amazing place in our great town.
Thank you. Haven Vincent Warner.
A wonderland. That is exactly what I see as I enter the Tilton. From the perfect book I will curl up in my room with, to that movie that will later become memories of giggles and laughter, and that magazine that I look through for hours, searching for that page I thought I saw. When I was thinking about the library, I realized that without it, I would never have even discovered many of the great books, movies, and magazines that I've enjoyed over the years. But our library, the Tilton, is even more than that. It's a community and a home. I've been coming to the Tilton ever since I was little. I always thought it was amazing that a place could hold so many books. I remember coming here, and my family would check out stacks and stacks of books. When I got my library card, I was ecstatic. I could double the amount of books we took out. As a little kid, one of my favorite things was the much-anticipated story time. I would ask my mom, when can we go to story time? All week. And then after we went, I would ask until we went again. I loved getting to sit with my friends and listen to Julie read stories about one thing or another. I can't imagine my life without it. Monday night music has always been something to look forward to. A sign that summer was really here, and with the last bittersweet session, a sign that summer was coming to a close. It's so nice that a library is something like Monday night music. A time for our town to come together to listen to great local music as we hang out with friends eating squeeze pops. Imagine what else we would do on Monday summer evenings if we didn't have Monday night music. I've always loved to read, but I don't think I would have been able to grow as such an avid reader without the library. I would have missed so many great books. For me, the library is kind of like a candy store. So many good choices, all of them delicious. Plus, the library is really like family. Julie and Katie, who I miss very much, Sarah, and everyone have been a regular part of my life, literally for as long as I can remember. It is pretty great to grow up in a town where the library is like a home away from home. I love that whenever I'm at the library, I always see a face I know. The library really helps me to appreciate our great community even more. Without the library, who knows who I'd be friends with? Our library is so great, and imagine, it has been lighting up people's lives for 100 years. That is just so incredible that people have been appreciating Tilton for so long. I have so many great memories of the library. Story time, when I first got my library card, Monday night music, coming here with my friends after school, and the Battle of the Books, and so much more. I would just like to say I'm so thankful that we have a town library that brings such a joy to our entire community.
Well, thank you, all speakers. We really appreciate hearing your thoughts on the library, and thank you to everyone for coming today. My name is Kate Hayes. I'm a member of the 100th Anniversary Committee, and I'm also on the board of the Friends of the Library. And I want everyone to be sure that they understand that this is just the first event that we've planned for a whole year. We have many programs and activities coming up, and we hope that we will see you at some of those in the future. My task today is to close this program, and we're going to be doing that by singing in just a moment the first stanza of America. And America was chosen because in the November 1916 original dedication, that was how they closed their program. We thought it would be a fine idea to close ours that way as well. After that, we'd like to invite you into the library to have cake. That's going to be on the main floor. There's refreshments on the lower level as well. And if any of you would like to have a tour of the library, I understand that staff are available to do that. While you're in there, please do take a look at the 100th anniversary quilt that some local crafters have made for us for this year. It's going to be on display throughout the year and will be raffled off at our final event next October. And while you're there, please also take a look at the artwork that's been donated by local artists for the Friends of the Library art auction. Silent bidding on that goes till November 18th, so you still have time to get in on the action. So with that, again, I want to thank everyone for coming, and Jay. You don't know the words hum.
All right, you can enter probably maybe which way do you want people to enter?
Any way
you can get up there. It's take time.
Hi. Nice to see you. That was so cool.